Hello, everyone, and welcome to our 21st annual breakfast. That's right, 21 years. For those that don't know me, my name is Phil Zoshak. I'm the development manager here at Literacy Source, and I am thrilled to once again be your MC for the breakfast. Speaking of breakfast, I just had mine, had a lovely cup of coffee, and then my all-time favorite breakfast, cold pizza. And I want to know in chat, do you agree with me? Is cold pizza the best breakfast of all time? Or perhaps it's even the bestest, greatest breakfast of all time because there is no downside to cold pizza. I will die on this hill. Anyway, let me know in chat. I'm super excited to hear what everyone is eating, drinking. Maybe I have some fellow cold pizzaers in the chat, so let me know. If you haven't heard of Literacy Source before, or if you're new to the breakfast, or heck, if you've been coming to the breakfast for the past 21 years, welcome. We are so excited to have you. And let me give you a quick rundown of what we do at Literacy Source. So we provide over 600 adults each year free education classes, and most of our students are immigrants and refugees. The theme of the breakfast this year is building our future. And so everything that you'll see today will be focused around what the future looks like for both our students and our organization. And if it hasn't been fairly obvious, ta-da! We have a brand new logo. It's a small step and a rather large undertaking that our co-executive directors, Kat and Shira, will be talking more about in just a bit. And of course, the breakfast is our biggest fundraiser of the year. I would be amiss to not mention that. Our goal this year is $165,000 to fully support our classes and programs and to ensure that they stay free for our students. I'd like to thank our sponsors today. The fact that we have sponsorships is amazing, and that means that each dollar that you can give today will go directly to our programs, as our sponsors have been kind enough to underwrite the cost of producing this program. I'd also like to thank our board of directors and some key donors for building a robust matching pool again. For those that don't know, the matching pool is a pool of funds used to match all donations. So this year, donations of $300 to $500 will be matched. And this is something new, donations of $1,000 or more will be doubly matched. That's right, doubly matched. So a gift of $1,000 is actually a gift of $3,000. So once again, thank you to our board of directors and key donors for making this matching pool possible. And I hope this will entice you to stretch your gifts just a bit more. As always, if you donate $500 or more throughout the year, you will be enrolled into our Educator Circle program. This is a way to celebrate our donors, and there are lovely activities, events planned throughout the year. Our first one will be a walking tour of our neighborhood, Lake City, with myself and our co-executive director, Shira Rosen. So if you would love to connect with your other donors, meet the staff and the team here, it's a great opportunity, and I encourage you to join our educator circle. All right, well, I think that's enough chatting from me. I'm going to send it over to Kat and Shira, our co-executive directors, and they'll be talking more about building our future. Welcome to the breakfast, everyone, and I really hope you enjoy it. All right, let's get to it.
Hi, and welcome. I'm Kat Howell, Co-Executive Director, Educational Director at Literacy Source, and thank you for joining us today.
And I'm Shira Rosen, the Managing Co-Executive Director here at Literacy Source. We are really glad that you're here today, and we hope you enjoy our program. I started working here about 2.5 years ago when the Co-Executive Director model first began. Kat manages everything related to programming, and I manage things related to operations. Each of us gets to work in the area where we find joy and also partner together on a bunch of different things. I would say that shared leadership is the way to go. And why do I say that? Because we can actually be in two places at once. Over these last 2 years, Literacy Source has definitely had some changes, similar to all of you with the pandemic and coming out of things and all of that. But my biggest personal favorite is having in-person classes again, where I get to meet students face-to-face. Each day, I come into the office. I talk to amazing people from all over the world, working to gain skills for their future. I really couldn't think of a better place to be, and I know many of you know exactly what I'm talking about. And what a great place to be today as we unveil our new logo, which you can see right behind us. What do you see in our new logo? Please comment in the chat. I would love to hear what you see in this image. At Literacy Source, we're building our future as an anti-racist, equity-driven, human-centered organization and learning experience. Our designer embraces who we are and created a symbol that represents growth, rebirth, and positive change, with a doorway to our school and leaves that look like books. We're really excited to go forward and build our future with this new design. To further build our future, we have a strategic plan that has three main areas to it: pay equity, moving our office, and program operations. At Literacy Source, we have a commitment to diversity, equity, and inclusion at the individual and the systems level. We have racial equity caucusing, trainings, and activities that support each staff member in their DEI journey. We also work at the systems level, where we've changed our personnel policies so we can better meet staff needs, and we're also working really hard on pay equity. With pay equity, we're asking ourselves, how do you pay staff well enough to live in Seattle? How do we pay staff compared to other organizations? How do we pay people a wage that will encourage them to stay at Literacy Source because we have an amazing staff and we really don't want to lose them? If we don't pay well enough, we're limited in who we can hire and we'll have trouble retaining quality staff. If our students are willing to put in the time and the energy to be in our classes and learn, we want them to have the best experience possible and the best instructors possible. Moving. We learned that our current site here in Lake City is going to be redeveloped for affordable housing and that we're going to have to move out in about 2 years. In the coming year, you'll definitely hear more as we decide what our next steps are going to be and where we might move. For program operations, though, I'm going to give it back to Kat because she has way more knowledge in this area than I do.
Thanks, Shira. Just as we are strategically strengthening our organization, we must continue to focus on building our capacity in our educational programs. Our students are building their futures, improving their English, getting U.S. citizenship, getting jobs, completing their GED, making more sense of math, learning to use computers better, and building a robust learning community. In our educational programs, we partner with our students to identify their goals and then design instruction to help them learn, and it's working. We see this with students achieving their goals. For example, U.S. citizenship, where almost 70% of our students last year made gains in writing, but also because they come to class. They participate and they refer their friends and community members to our classes. This shows up because almost 90% of our students stay in class and return and persist until they meet their goals. And our classes stay full, especially at the lower levels. And students come to Literacy Source with many different personal goals. As you will see from the students speaking today, they may have goals around citizenship, family reunification, accessing medical or other systems, or their careers. And we tailor our instruction to meet these goals. And our students, like all of us, see a recurring need for greater digital skills. And as a result, we've created more access for students and flexibility for volunteers and staff, with both in-person and online classes and tutoring, and have embedded practical, necessary digital skills in all the work that we do. So students are then using these relevant digital skills in class that they can transfer and use in their lives. As an example, when our students join classes from home, it's important for them to be able to manage their technology to fully participate, but also not disturb other students And this can be a problem sometimes with family life continuing in the background, with kids disturbing, cooking, the TV on. In our ESL1 online class, some of the first skills they learn are to ask and answer, can you see me? Can you hear me? And to mute, unmute, and turn on and off their video. This is a huge skill, no easy feat, and really improves the quality of the class for themselves and for everyone else, and is a transferable skill they can use in any online appointments like at the doctor or wherever else they may go. Students also practice logging into email and using the shift key and non-numeric characters in their online passwords daily to access their homework or just in class. And this is intentional practice of an embedded key digital safety skill, part of our curriculum. Sometimes class content also focuses on specific digital skills, like in the fall Ready to Work curriculum, when the class works through and learns how to fill out online job applications. And this fall, one student reported that after working on the online applications unit in class, she was able to successfully apply for jobs online and start working.
So as you can tell from all of this, we're really building our future here together at Literacy Source. And we invite you to join with students, volunteers, and staff to create a positive, welcoming, nurturing future where we make it possible for adults to gain the basic literacy skills they need in order to succeed in school, to find a job, to achieve life goals, and to create a better, more hopeful future.
And as students are building their future, we provide high quality, explicit, and culturally relevant instruction that's based on their goals. And this shows up in the next segment that you'll see from our in-person citizenship class. As you watch, notice the class content, which is really specific to passing the naturalization exam. And notice how Eric, the teacher, includes student names and information like about their countries and about them in the lesson to make the class more personal. And last, really notice how he provides really explicit grammar and spelling instruction based off the lesson, like material and patterns of English that students are ready to learn.
Good job. Okay, let's try the first one. What's the first one? Americans have. Good job. Okay. How do we spell civil? Good. Civil. Good job. Civil rights. Okay, the I-G-H-T. Yeah, because more than one. Yeah, many rights. But did you put, yeah, you put R. I-G-H-T. Yep, you're correct. You just need an S. We have many. Remember, what is right? Right means you can do it. You want to vote? You can go vote. Yep. You want to say, the president is good, or the president is bad? You can do it. Yeah? Civil rights. Civil means citizen, society. Yeah? Yes. Okay, next one. Okay, good. How do we spell? Good job. Good job. Perfect. Country, right? Guatemala, Uruguay, Ethiopia, USA, America, country. Yeah? Yeah, good. How do we freedom of? S. Good. Good job. Yeah. Speech. Freedom of speech is a. Okay, good. Right. R-I-G-H-T. One right.
Yeah.
One right. Many rights. Yes. Okay, good. Again, no problem?
Yes.
Okay, so remember, speech. In English, we say E.
Yeah.
Oh. C. Okay? Feed. Yeah, feed is give food to the animal. Feed.
Yes.
Seed.
Seed.
Seed. Yes. For the plant. Give a little give water. Okay. Yeah, good. Very good. Then speech. Can you say that? Perfect. Okay, good. Last one. Good question. American. Why only one? Because we have S. So you don't need to say Americans. You just say American citizens. Can. How do we spell vote?
Vote.
Good. E, no sound. Yeah? No sound. It vote. Very good. Good job. Yeah? Perfect. Yeah. Let me see. Good copy. Yes, no problem. So, okay, so together. Yeah.
Yeah, it's okay.
Sure, I know you put SPI. Okay, that's okay. Remember, on the test, when they ask you to write, you don't need 100%, very good, but you don't need 100%. You need maybe 85. Okay? So you can have one or two small mistake. Okay? Don't need to be perfect. Okay? Alright? But it's good to be, we try.
Hello, everyone. My name is Eric Bodlander, and I am the instructor here at Literacy Source of the in-person citizenship class. As you can see, that is me teaching a typical citizenship class in the morning. And you can see that there are four students. Currently, the class size is quite small due to the fact that we are slowly growing the program after that pandemic, right? Literacy Source had to shut down in-person classes during the pandemic. Now that we've started a few quarters back, we're slowly growing the program, and the hope is to get more and more students who are comfortable coming back to study citizenship in person. Let me now explain the purpose of the class. The purpose of the citizenship class is to help students prepare for their citizenship interview, as well as to get them comfortable in using English in everyday situations. The citizenship test has, citizenship interview rather, has three components. There is a civics component in which the interviewee has to answer six questions correctly. They have 10 chances on US history and US government. And the second component is a reading and writing component. The interviewee is asked to read a sentence and then is asked to write a sentence they hear. The next component is the N400 part of the interview, and the N400 is the citizenship application that they have filled in prior to being asked to interview. And during the interview, the officer will go over the form that the interviewee has filled out and just confirm things, information about the interviewee. And so this is more of a spoken part of the test, and it can be quite difficult for students because there are a lot of questions that are pretty detailed and very specific and have to do with legal aspects. And so our class, the citizenship class here at Literacy Source, tries to prepare the students for all of these, all three components of the citizenship interview. And really the goal for me as an instructor is not only to see my students pass the citizenship interview and to see the happiness and joy that they have when they do, but it's also to give them the confidence that they can use English in everyday situations here in America, but more importantly, to participate in democracy here by voting, for example. All right, so that's just a quick overview of the citizenship class that I teach here at Literacy Source, and thank you for listening. Bye-bye.
We've looked at a class, and now let's hear from some of our students. Xing Chuang is originally from China and wants to bring his family to the States. Miriam was a teacher in Venezuela and is now learning English to continue her teaching career. Two different people with two different paths, yet both are building their future. And I think it's important to say, our students have many different paths to Literacy Source. Some people are learning to write for the first time, while others have their PhDs. And with that in mind, I'd like to introduce you to Xing Chuang and Miriam.
I speak Chinese. 我叫刘清川，今年61岁，我来自中国，我是去年的12月2号来到美国，我现在是我妈妈的一个护理员，我在这里学习英语是在今年的3月份开始的，刚开始的时候我是从ABC开始学习，现在我能够说一些简单的日常英语了，我非常喜欢这个地方。因为我在这儿，结识了很多的朋友，像我的老师 Julia， Gato， 还有阿燕，我还结识了我的一些同学，像图安、穆罕默德，在这里，反正我感到非常高兴。非常快乐，我不仅在这儿，学习到了英语，而且结识了好多的朋友，我想，在这儿，我想在这儿像一个正常的美国人那样去生活。这也是我的一个美国梦吧。因为我喜欢这个地方，因为我到这个课堂里头呢，就感到非常的高兴，非常的快乐。在这里我不仅能够学到了英语，而且结识了一些朋友。因为我在这儿能学到英语以后呢，我能够给我妈妈更好的生活，我可以到去找一些更好的一些工作， 来改善我妈妈的生活。所以呢，我非常喜欢这个地方。学习英语，最重要的就是我可以去听懂对方能说什么，我们能够交流起来。这就是我学习的一个最大的动力。我刚才说了，我喜欢这个地方，我在这儿感到生活就比较快乐。不像以前刚来到美国这什么也听不懂，干得很压抑。但是到这儿呢，有这么些朋友来帮助我，我会感到非常的高兴，生活的非常充实。而且这个学校呢，给我了很多的帮助。你想上学，免费提供你一个电脑，让你去学习。所以说，我非常喜欢这个地方。这么好的事情，不可能人家不喜欢。这是我非常喜欢这儿。目前为止，我最大的期望就是想着家庭团聚。目前我是一个人来照顾我妈妈，我想有一天能够把我的夫人以及我的儿子孙子都移到美国来，这就是我一个美国梦。
Mi nombre es Miriam, soy de Venezuela, también soy profesora, fui profesora en mi país y vengo de una familia numerosa, casi éramos 11 hermanos. Mis hijos, los tres hijos que tengo están aquí, viven aquí. Yo tuve que venirme de Venezuela por la situación país que vivimos, política, económica. Y en 2013 llegué aquí, en 2014 tuve la residencia. Y desde entonces, bueno, intenté estudiar el idioma para presentar el examen de la ciudadanía. Me vine y estoy aprendiendo a conocer el país, la cultura, la seguridad que hay aquí, el sistema político de este país, es lo que más me gusta. Los ciudadanos tienen derechos, se les respeta. Y bueno, mis hijos están aquí, son dos ciudadanos y uno está con asilo político y esperando que lo llamen para la entrevista. De mí puedo decirles que me gusta mucho enseñar, es lo que yo he hecho toda mi vida y quiero aprender y mejorar mi inglés para poder comunicarme mejor con la gente, con las personas. Estaba buscando literacy, eso lo encontré por internet. Estaba buscando un lugar donde estudiar y encontré este sitio. Vine aquí, pregunté y me ofrecieron que sí tenían las clases para, en aquel momento, para la ciudadanía, la citizenship. Una vez que comencé con las clases, lo que me hizo quedarme aquí es el personal. Todas las personas que yo conocí que me trataron fueron muy amables, muy atentas conmigo, muy dispuestas siempre a ayudar. Y comencé las clases en persona, en el aula. Pero en ese momento vino la pandemia y la suspendieron. Se suspendieron por un tiempo. Continué luego en línea. Y bueno, la mejor experiencia que tengo sobre el idioma inglés fue de verdad la calidad profesional de las personas que me estaban orientando, ayudando y asesorando y enseñando. Pasé como un año y unos meses estudiando en línea 2 veces por semana. Realmente fue un éxito realmente todo lo que pude aprender. Mi entrevista la tuve en julio pasado. Aprobé y en este momento ya soy ciudadana de los Estados Unidos. Bien. Jeff, sí, yo como profesora que soy, sé que lo mejor es tener las clases en vivo, porque las dudas se aclaran en el momento. Y realmente las personas que me han asignado o con las que he estado aquí estudiando, tanto en línea como en persona, son personas excelentes. Yo he recomendado este centro a otras personas que puedan venir aquí porque realmente la metodología, la filosofía de Jesús es excelente. Se transmiten a los docentes y los docentes a los que estamos aquí aprendiendo. Además de esto, he conocido personas de todas partes del mundo con las que compartíamos las clases de Corea del Sur, de Japón, China, diferentes países. Y eso también ha ampliado mi círculo social. Me ha ayudado mucho, en realidad. Es excelente. Para el futuro, lo que yo aspiro es ser, si no una experta, una buena comunicadora en inglés. Ser una persona que se puede comunicar, que puedo entender a los demás y que me pueden entender a mí. Es mi objetivo. Una vez con eso, buscar un trabajo que me permita enseñar, hacer lo que yo sé hacer. Ese es mi objetivo.
Okay, so like the Super Bowl halftime show, I decided for a quick costume change. Okay, I get one bad joke a year. I think that covers it.
We hope you enjoyed the opportunity to see inside a classroom and get an explanation from Eric to walk us through his thinking as he teaches. Our citizenship students are lucky to have such a passionate, thoughtful instructor to help build their futures.
And I appreciate Shishuan and Marion sharing their reasons for being in classes and their goals, which are to bring their family to Seattle or resume her career as a teacher. And Halfia is such an inspiration, and I'm so glad she wanted to be part of the Literacy Source staff. We want to have enough resources to continue this work, and you can help us get there. Next, here is Priya Singh, one of our board members, to let you know more about how you can be part of building our future.
Hello, I am Priya Singh, and I am a proud board member at Literacy Source. I'm going to start by telling you a little story. About 11 years ago, give or take, I was running a little program in Central Seattle and helping families and parents engage with their children in their education. I sat down with a group of moms and said, hey, we're going to talk about how to help your children and all of these grand plans. And before they could, I could even explain it, they stopped me and they said, Priya, we need to learn how to read. The best way for us to help our children is for us to know how to read. And that was eye-opening for me. So I did not know about how to teach English. So I started asking around. I asked other nonprofits and they said, go to Literacy Source. I asked the Seattle Public Libraries. They said, go to Literacy Source. I went to a professor at Seattle University, Bob Hughes, shout out if you're there. And he said, go to Literacy Source. I was amazed at how much I kept hearing about this organization. And I expected it to be, millions and millions of dollars with a big, big building and lots of hustle and bustle. And when I showed up, it was a tiny place in Fremont doing amazing educational work, amazing educational work. I could see from the deliberate way that they were thinking about every single thing they taught, every single thing that they were weaving together in every lesson, that this place was special. And so I went back to my moms in the Central District and I said, okay, let's think about how we can incorporate things from Literacy Source. And so that's what we did. Those moms were not alone in not knowing how to read or write in English. In fact, there are 43 million people in the United States who can't read, write, or do basic math above a third grade level. My grandmother was one of them. She was an immigrant to the United States, sadly has passed. When she came here, I remember my father programming her home phone number to be able to call his office. And she was not able to read the numbers on the phone. So it wasn't just as quick as press the one and be connected to my dad's office. She had to learn it by the colors of the buttons. Hit the red button and you'll get my dad, and hit the blue button and you'll get an uncle. And that stuck with me. And there are 43 million others out there who are similar. Literacy Source is so much more than a place to learn English. You know, as you heard from our students and from Kat and Shira and from Eric, we provide, we being board members, donors, volunteers, you, teachers, the whole community, we are helping them meet their goals. We are helping them think about how to speak English to communicate with a medical professional, or to submit a job application online, or to become a teacher yourself. It's about achieving their dreams. It's not about what we think they should be doing with their lives, but about what they want to achieve with literacy and making that dream come true for them. And we know it's working because 90% of the students complete the course. And how huge is that? Because adults vote with their feet. If they don't like it, they will walk away. And with that 90% completion rate, we need you, you in the community, to give to Literacy Source to continue this programming for many more decades to come. Right now, someone is popping into chat the link to Literacy Source. It is literacysource.org, and then you'll hit the big donate button. And after I come off the screen, there will be a couple of slides, and there will also be an address so you can mail a physical check if that is your preference. Enjoy the hold music. We will have a couple minutes for you to make those donations, and then we'll hear from Nancy Pearl. So lucky to be a board member at Literacy Source, and I hope you learned a lot about the organization today. Thank you so much.
Your donation can go further with these quick tips. First, gifts between $300 and $500 will be matched. Gifts of over $1,000 will be triple matched, so your $1,000 becomes $3,000. And finally, if you're a donor who gives more than $500 per year, you are invited to our Educator Circle, where we have 4 special events for donors only. We look forward to your gifts. Thank you.
folks, it is my pleasure to introduce the amazing Nancy Pearl.
Hello, so happy to be with you again this year to talk about some good books to read. The first book that I want to tell you about is a biography, and it's by a man named Peter Canellos. It's called The Great Dissenter, John Marshall Harlan, America's Judicial Hero. And it's a fascinating biography of a Supreme Court justice who served for 34 years, from 1877 to 1911. And John Marshall Harlan dissented in three big civil rights cases. He had been born to a slaveholding family, and he was an advocate when he was placed on the Supreme Court. He was an advocate of the institution itself, and then grew in his position as a Supreme Court justice, became a strong proponent of the Union, and he was a strong defender, as we see in the book, of First Amendment rights. The big case that John Marshall Harlan dissented in was Plessy versus Ferguson. And I should say that in each of these cases, John Marshall Harlan was the sole dissenter, and each of these cases was later overturned by other Supreme Courts that were to come. He was a brave man, and you could read those dissents. The big dissent was Plessy versus Ferguson, which was the 1896 case that established that separate but equal doctrine. I have to say, I did not ever hear of John Marshall Harlan before I read this book. I actually talked about the book to a group of lawyers, and it appeared that none of them had heard about John Marshall Harlan either. So I was glad that with this book, maybe more people will come to know this fascinating, fascinating individual. It's not written for academics necessarily. It's really written for people like us who might be interested in learning more about American history. So that's The Great Dissenter. The next book is a novel by Mark Haber. Mark Haber is a bookseller in Austin, Texas. This is a book called St. Sebastian's Abyss. And you will be able to tell in the first 20 pages whether you want to go on reading this book. So it's really going to be a book that you either love or you just don't get and aren't interested. I loved it. I thought it was so funny, and it is of the genre of academic satires, which is a genre of books that I happen to really enjoy. So, St. Sebastian's Abyss is about two men who meet as students, they're art history students in Oxford, and kind of simultaneously, they fall in love with a particular painting. A painting called St. Sebastian's Abyss, which was painted by a Dutch Renaissance painter named Count Hugo Beckenbauer. And these two men go on to have sterling careers as art historians, and each of them writes six or seven, maybe more, books about, guess what, St. Sebastian's Abyss and Count Hugo Beckenbauer. Now, just to save you time Googling, I will say here that the painting, St. Sebastian's Abyss, and Count Hugo Beckenbauer are entirely fictitious, which is a lot of the fun. Now, these two men are good friends. They're you know, really good buddies, and share this obsession with this painting. Until one of them, the narrator, says something horrible, and that this is referred to in the book as that quote, that horrible thing I said, close quote. And the two are no longer friends. They have broken, that friendship is totally broken. And then out of the blue, many years later, the narrator gets a letter from a long letter, email letter from his former friend who is in Europe and is dying and has asked the narrator to come to his deathbed, which the narrator, of course, does. As we're reading the book, one of the things that we learn is that this obsession with this painting that these two men share has caused, among other things, a lost friendship, etc., has caused the two divorces that the narrator has gone through. I just have to say, this is a little book. It's not particularly long. The chapters are a page and a half long, and it is so much fun. But as I started this part of the talk by saying, this is a book you'll know really, really early on whether you like it or not. And if you don't like it, stop reading it. Okay. The next book on the list is so different from St. Sebastian's Abyss. It's one of those, it's great to talk about them in sequence to just show the range of what's possible in novels. Last year, I talked to you about a book called Zori by Laird Hunt. Zori is Zorrie. It's the story of a young woman growing up, her life, really, during the first half of the 20th century, mainly on a farm in Indiana. When you're reading that book, there's an event that happens with Zori, and you learn a little bit about the man who is involved in that event. But it turns out that Laird Hunt's first novel, written many years ago, has just been republished by a small, independent, very quirky press in Canada called Coffee House Press. I always look forward to see what they're publishing, what they're up to. Coffee House Press just brought out Laird Hunt's very first novel, which is called Indiana, Indiana, which is the story of that event that is referred to and described very briefly in Zori. I would say, if I were going to read these books, and I hope you do, because they're characterized by the same very spare, very beautiful writing. And he's writing about ordinary people who live extraordinary lives in their ordinariness, if that makes any sense. The phrase about we all contain multitudes. Zori contains multitudes, as does the main character in Indiana, Indiana. So if I were you, and these books sounded interesting, I would begin with Zori, even though it was published much later, and then go back and read Indiana, Indiana. Both of them are absolutely wonderful. The next book is a novel by an Australian writer, Fiona McFarlane. I think the cover is just so perfect for the book. The book is called The Sun Walks Down, and the cover is bright orange, and you could see an even deeper orange sun on the cover. Take a look at that. It's set in 1883 in the Australian outback. And a little boy, a six-year-old boy, goes missing during a dust storm. And this is the story of the search for this little boy. It's told from multiple points of view, including the little boy himself, who is kind of relating what is happening to him. Among these different viewpoints are the indigenous trackers who are searching for him, artists who are searching for him, school teachers, the whole town, the small town named Fairly, F-A-I-R-L-Y, is out there looking for this lost little boy, policemen, of course, the boy's family. And so in reading their stories as well, you really get a picture of colonial Australia and what that was like in the late 19th century. I loved this book. The next book, one of the nice things that happens occasionally is that I find a book, where I've never read anything by the author, and I just really enjoy the book, and then I discover, to my delight, that there's 6 or 7 older titles and 1 or 2 even newer titles. That's what happened with Natasha Pulley's book called The Kingdoms. This is an alternate history. It's set in an England that is not our England. It's the 19th century. England is a French colony. They have lost the Battle of Trafalgar under Lord Nelson. Scotland is a rebel territory. And a man arrives in England at the underground stop. He doesn't know where he is. He doesn't know who he is. He doesn't know why he's there. All he has is a postcard signed with the letter M. And he decides he's going to find out, because he wants to know who he is and why what's happened and why he's there. This is a book that has everything. It's a love story. It has time travel. It has war at sea. It's just a really immersive, just a book that just captures you. And even if you're not a fan of science fiction and fantasy, take a look at this just to see what happens. You know, I said I had never heard of Natasha Pulley, the author of the book, before I just picked this book up. I have no idea why. Many people were introduced to Natasha Pulley and became huge fans with their first novel, The Watchmaker of Filigree Street, which I read later after I loved The Kingdoms, and just thought that was just a wonderful, wonderful novel too. So there's an author for you to explore, Natasha Pulley. Lastly, I want to talk quickly about another nonfiction book. It's by Michael Shulman, S-C-H-U-L-M-A-N. He's a writer for The New Yorker, and his new book, he wrote a book about Meryl Streep, but his new book is called Oscar Wars, A History of Hollywood in Gold, Sweat, and Tears. And what he's done is not a whole history of Hollywood. There have been plenty of histories of Hollywood, plenty of histories of the Oscar awards. But what he's done is pulled out different Oscars, different times that really illuminate the period in which those Oscars took place. So we learn about the beginning of the Academy. Douglas Fairbanks and Mary Pickford had a big hand in starting the Academy, how the different categories were chosen, what categories, you know, that they had originally that they no longer have. And then different events that happened at different Academy Awards. I'm not a big movie fan. I don't always watch the Oscars, but I have to say I spent a lot of time on YouTube while I was reading this book. You know, I put down the book and look up the YouTube of the event that he's talking about in this book. The one that I loved, you remember a recent Oscar Awards where the winner of the Best Picture they announced was the wrong Best Picture, and that was Warren Beatty announcing that this particular picture had won. Everybody came up, and then it was discovered, oh no, that's a mistake. And so the real people came up, the real winners, it was announced. What I loved about that is that Warren Beatty refused to give up the card with the wrong name of it, with the wrong winner, because he wanted to, as we say in mystery novels, preserve the chain of evidence, except this wasn't a mystery novel, and Warren Beatty had no reason to hang on to that card. That's just the kind of thing that Michael Shulman has written about in this book. Lots of little facts that would be fun to, you know, to bring up at dinner parties if you, unlike me, go to dinner parties. I recently had the opportunity, the pleasant opportunity, to interview Minjin Lee, who is a Korean-American writer. And she, her backstory is that she came to the United States with her parents as a child, and grew up and went to Yale and became a lawyer, and then decided she didn't really want to be a lawyer and started writing. And she writes big books, two big novels, and her subject really in those two novels and in a forthcoming novel that she's working on now is the Korean diaspora. So the first book, Free Food for Millionaires, is about Koreans in the U.S. But her second book, which is the one I want to tell you a little bit more about, is Pachinko, and it's about Koreans in Japan. The book spans four generations of a Korean family. It begins in 1910, which was when the Japanese colonized Korea, and it ends in 1989, pretty much the modern era, going through the horrors of World War II, of course. And what I really thought, what I loved about this book was how much I learned. And there were things that I didn't know about the Japanese colonization of Korea. I didn't know that after when the United States, after the Korean War, when Korea was split into North and South Korea, that many Koreans who had grown up in what had become the North were repatriated there. Were told, according to Min Jin Lee, all sorts of stories that it was the land of milk and honey and how wonderful it would be to be there. And of course, we know what those people didn't know then, what a hard life they would have in North Korea. So this book, Pachinko, is really an epic, and it's one of those very readable novels where you finish it and you remember the characters and you remember what happens to them and how that has played out over the course of the novel. So that's Pachinko. It was a finalist for the National Book Award in 2017. And I hope you like it as much as I did. Okay, I'm glad I had this chance to tell you about all these books. I hope you find at least one that you really enjoy. Thank you.
Thank you so much for joining our breakfast today. I had a blast hosting, and I hope you all enjoyed it. Also, your generosity helps continue to build our future, and thank you so much for your support. I'd like to thank Eric's morning citizenship class, Xing Chuang, Mariam, and Halfia for allowing us to see their progress and hear their stories. I'd also like to thank Nancy Pearl for offering fantastic book recommendations. I personally can't wait to read Min Jin Lee's book. And finally, I'd like to thank our sponsors who stepped up and supported this event. I hope you can leave here today feeling inspired and hopeful for the future. Have a wonderful day, everyone.